wish I were in a long sea voyage somewhere. Not too much deck tennis, no frantic dancing, and no responsibility. Why me? I look around that bridge. I see the men waiting for me to make the next move. And Bones, what if I'm wrong?
Who's in charge here?
Me, sir.
How long is this going to take you?
I don't know, sir.
You know what's going on here?
Yes, sir.
No, I don't think you do. Let me explain it to you. If we launch and we're wrong, what's left of Russia is going to launch at us. There will be a nuclear holocaust beyond imagination. So it's all about knowing, Mr. Bosler. We have to know whether or not our order to launch has been recalled or not. The only way we're going to know is if you fix that radio. You understand me?
Yes, sir.
You ever watch Star Trek?
Star Trek,
the USS Enterprise. All right, you remember when the Klingons were going to blow up the Enterprise and Captain Kirk calls down to Scotty? He says, Scotty, I got to have more power.
He needs more warp speed.
Warp speed, exactly. Yeah. Well, I'm Captain Kirk, you're Scotty, I need more power. I'm telling you, if you do not get this radio up, a billion people are going to die. Now, it's all up to you. I know that's a shaky deal, but you got it. Can you handle it? Scotty.
Bye, Captain.
Live from Hollywood, a 30th anniversary salute to Star Trek. Tonight, from Alpha Centauri 4 all the way to Paramount Studios, join Ted Danson and some of Star Trek's biggest fans as they pay tribute to the largest gathering of Star Trek cast members of all time. With tributes from LeVar Burton, Joan Collins, Kenny G, Perry Gilpin, David Hyde Pierce, John Larroquette, Jane Leaves, John Mahoney, Kate Mulgrew, Leonard Nimoy, William Shatner, Patrick Stewart, and Ben Stiller. Ladies and gentlemen, Ted Danson.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Good evening, Vulcans and Romulans. Good evening, Klingons, Bajorans, Cardassians, Betazoids, and silicone-based life forms. Whew. It doesn't matter if you're someone who's only seen Star Trek a couple of times, or if you're one of those who have an accurate, homemade Starfleet uniform hanging in the back of your closet. You do know who Captain Kirk is. You know who Mr. Spock is. And most likely there have been times when you found yourself in a jam and wish you could reach for that little communicator and say, beam me up, Scotty. Keep your eye on me. We're live, Scotty. Well, here we are tonight to celebrate the 30th anniversary of Star Trek and to see how the power of a single idea can become so important to so many millions around the world. We'll be taking a look back to great moments from Star Trek. We'll also find out about Gene Roddenberry, a man who proved that treating the audience like an intelligent species can really pay off. He used to say, we talked about things you couldn't talk about. Sex, religion, labor, hunger, world peace, all that stuff. And the marvelous thing was that it went right over the network's heads. But the 14 and 16-year-olds in the audience knew exactly what we were talking about. Now, I have a very personal connection with this evening. Actually, I have two. First, my wife's ex-husband killed Captain Kirk. But the main connection has to do with the charities that benefit from this evening. The permanent charities of the entertainment industries, communities and schools, the Robert F. Kennedy Memorial Center for Human Rights, and an organization particularly close to my heart, the American Oceans Campaign. Each of these organizations works every day to make sure that our society makes it to Star Trek's 24th century, ensuring that we all live long and prosper.
Captain of the Enterprise.
That's right.
Close to retirement?
I'm not planning on it.
Let me tell you something. Don't. Don't let them promote you. Don't let them transfer you. Don't let them do anything that takes you off the bridge of that ship, because while you're there, you can make a difference.
Come back with me. Help me stop Solon. Make a difference again.
Who am I to argue with the captain of the Enterprise? What's the name of that planet? Viridian 3?
Yes.
I take it the odds are against us and the situation is grim.
You could say that.
You know, if Spock were here, he'd say that I was an irrational, illogical human being for taking on a mission like that. Sounds like fun.
Enterprise.
Arm aft photon torpedoes. Place them on ready status.
We're Starfleet officers. We're just part of the job.
Don't tell me. You're from outer space.
No, I'm from Iowa. I only work in outer space.
Everybody remember where we parked.
Lock faces. And locking faces. Ray shields.
Fire!
Help Warp 1 engage!
Once again, we've saved civilization as we know it.
And the good news is they're not going to prosecute.
Ladies and gentlemen, Ben Stiller.
They asked me to come out here and tell you a little bit about the history of Star Trek, the juggernaut that launched a 30-year... I'm sorry. I feel a little stupid here. They didn't ask me to do anything. I asked them, actually. I begged them to let me be here, because I'm a huge, huge Star Trek fan. I mean, I can't believe I'm even sitting here in the same room with Mr. Sulu. Forgive me, Captain Sulu. I mean, as a kid, I grew up alone, totally alone, and I didn't have any friends, but there was always Star Trek, and... kids at school used to make fun of me. Ooh, look at the Trekker wearing his silly pointed ears. It's Trekkie, okay? But I didn't let it bother me, because I knew every night when I'd go home, there would be a certain vessel of the Starship Cruiser class, NCC 1700 series, that'd be waiting for me, waiting to dock right up here and take me where no man has gone before. Star Trek really was my best friend, and I took the time to learn everything about it. You know, I studied the ins and outs of the Enterprise. I got the Starfleet Manual, the Concordance. You know, a lot of people don't have any idea what a Jefferies tube is. I made it my business to understand. And as Star Trek continued to grow, you know, I grew up too. The new shows happened. I really wasn't into the new shows. The whole, I mean, Deep Space 12 and, you know, My Generation, wonderful, incredible stuff. But I'm a purist. The original 79 episodes, the original Aliens, the Gorn, the Mugatu, the pig-faced Tellarite, okay? How about the librarian, Mr. Ataz? Mr. Ataz, the librarian, A to Z? I got it. Yeah. I think my favorites, though, were the rogue band of space hippies that beam aboard the Enterprise in episode 75, Way to Eden. All right, does everybody remember Adam with the curly blonde hair and the thigh-high boots playing that funny little stringed instrument serenading Captain Kirk? Ba-ba-na-na, ba-ba-na-ba. Stiff man putting my mind in jail, and the judge bang the gavel and say, no bail. Gonna lick his hand and wag my tail. Herbert, Herbert, Herbert. We reach. Yeah. This is just Bones, Kirk, Scotty. I know you have real names that escape me at this moment. I can't believe it. I mean, you guys were my extended family. You taught me the facts of life. You know, I can't tell you how many times I go through a time portal, meet a girl, fall in love with her, come back, she's been dead 100 years. You guys taught me how to deal with that. You know? I mean, God, I learned how to fight watching Captain Kirk. Oh! That move. I love it. And now, as an adult, I realized that, you know, Star Trek wasn't conjectured in fantasy, but was based and grounded in a reality of simple truths. And it saddens me that to this day, you know, we can't all follow its edicts of peace and care for our fellow man. And I know, by the way, I'm not supposed to get political here, okay? But, you know, the reason this country still has not switched to dilithium crystals as a form of purer, cleaner, and yes, cheaper energy is beyond me. And Scotty can back me up on this. The big three oil companies know what's going down, and they refuse to acknowledge it. That's all I'm going to say about that. All my life, people have made fun of me because I was a Star Trek nerd. Well, here I am. You know, they look at me and they say, what's it going to get you in your life, right? I share the stage with the entire cast of Star Trek and Kenny G. Who's the nerd? All right, it's really been a pleasure to be here, and I'd just like to leave you with this brief history of Star Trek. Thank you. Take a look.
They beamed in from nowhere, but we knew them right away. The derring do captain, his loyal sidekick.
I cured it.
The crusty, warm-hearted doctor.
You're out of your Vulcan mind, Spock.
And a Mr. Fix-It.
Six.
Try her now, Mr. Kyle.
What we didn't know, and couldn't resist, was where they were going to take us each week. In 1964, Lucy and Desi's studio was looking for new shows to peddle to the networks, when in walked a freelance TV writer with a quirky, offbeat idea. Gene Roddenberry pitched it as Wagon Train to the Stars, set in the 23rd century. The pilot featured a Captain Christopher Pike and an overly angular alien.
You're not speaking, yet I can hear you.
You will note the confusion as it reads our thought transmissions.
All right, then, telepathy.
Too cerebral, said the network. Give us more action. This time, Captain James Tiberius Kirk commanded the first ever multi-planetary, multi-racial crew to hit the galaxy. And for the first time, the future looked really groovy. In September 1966, the voyage began, with hope for the future.
I think that one day they're going to take all the money that they spend now on war and death
and make them spend it on life.
Yes.
It was a cartoon epic, with all the thrill of an old-time Saturday morning serial.
Spock! What are you?
I am the guardian of forever.
Never mind the unusual costumes or the special effects on a shoestring budget. It was all the more endearing for trying.
You now have 7 minutes left.
We went willingly wherever they wanted to take us. And where they took us was to the really big stuff. The H.G. Wells kind of stuff. With questions about time, morality, mortality, and our very existence.
We have here an unusual opportunity to appraise the human mind, or to examine, in Earth terms, the roles of good and evil in a man.
Nothing but trouble from the Nielsens. Bad time slots, network disinterest, Romulan plots, whatever. The show just couldn't climb out of the ratings basement. Nearly a million pieces of pleading fan mail got the show a one-year reprieve, but the network execs finally shut it down.
Ladies and gentlemen, due to the low Nielsen ratings, we at NBC have decided to, unfortunately, cancel Star Trek.
Set phasers is done. Fire!
Nothing's happening, Jim. I can't understand it.
Well, and look, boys, you do me a favor and return these things to the property department, okay?
But there turned out to be an alternate, unexplored universe called Syndication. In it, the original 79 episodes lived long and prospered. Star Trek snowballed from a phenomenon into popular myth.
Hey, he's a man from outer space, and we're taking him to his spaceship.
Well, can't he just beam up?
This is reality, Greg.
Captain, Klingons off the starboard bow.
Again with the Klingons. Mr. Scott, give me full power.
It's no good, Captain. I cannot reach the control panel.
The myth was never far out of reach. It even became reality. In 1976, NASA paid its respects to Star Trek, naming its prototype space shuttle the Enterprise. 10 years after the original series was canceled, Star Trek the Motion Picture made its debut. Roddenberry's idea would be the cornerstone of 7 more motion pictures and 4 television series. In the Star Trek universe, there will always be another place to explore, another part of ourselves to discover.
Course heading, Captain.
Second star to the right. And straight on till morning.
Ladies and gentlemen, Joan Collins.
In 1967, when my 2 children finally entered school, I decided I wanted to go back to acting. And soon afterwards, my agent, Tom Corman, called to say I'd been offered a great part in a Star Trek episode. Star what? I said. It's a huge new cult show, said Tom. Obviously, you haven't been reading the trades. Oh, no, I've been too busy reading Mother and Child Care by Dr. Spock. Forget Dr. Spock, he said. Start thinking Mr. Spock. Ah, yes, I say. Of course, Mr. Spock, the one with the ears. Oh, the children love that show. Right, then you better do it. You'll probably be queen of the universe, possess intergalactic powers, wear tight, revealing costumes. Trust me, I'm your agent. A week later, I was cast as Edith Keeler, a saintly earthling who works as a social worker in a 1930s mission for down-and-out bums in New York's Bowery, and she happens to get hit by a truck. Thanks, Tom. I never fired a phaser. I never got to do this. Well, I can't do that anyway. And the closest I've ever been to the bridge is this set. Now, the episode I made, The City on the Edge of Forever, turned out to be one of the most popular Star Trek episodes ever. And it's still shown somewhere in the world every single week. In this episode, Captain Kirk and Mr. Spock return to 1930s New York. And whilst in the Big Apple, the captain falls in love with Edith Keeler. She believes that Hitler is a good guy, and she's involved in a pacifist movement that would delay World War II. So far, so good. Until Spock does a little research on his computer time machine and finds out that poor Edith is about to get hit by that truck. Love-struck, Captain Kirk cannot intervene, for to do so would change the course of history. So he just watches helplessly as Edith dies. A heavy subject yet, but not without its share of romance, because the on-screen passion between Kirk and Edith positively sizzled. I even heard that some of the crew were taking bets that I would succumb to the intergalactic charms of Captain Kirk. Sorry, but I didn't. And to this day, I still don't know if Edith slipped or was pushed in front of that truck. I have very fond memories of Star Trek, and I'm proud to have been a part of it. And in fact, when people say, "Aren't you Alexis Carrington, that bitch from Dynasty?" I smile sweetly and respond, "No, I'm Edith Keeler, Depression-era social worker from Star Trek." I've been a big fan ever since that introduction almost 30 years ago. And like the rest of you, I like a good story. But most of all, I love the wondrous gifts that Star Trek offers as it takes us to worlds that we could never imagine on our own.
If you can't take a little bloody nose, maybe you ought to go back home and crawl under your bed. It's not safe out here. It's wondrous, with treasures to satiate desires both subtle and gross. But it's not for the timid.
All stop.
Answering all stop, Captain.
According to the instrument, sir, our speed never exceeded warp 1.5.
All stop, sir.
Yes. But where is this place?
It's probing us.
Someone's idea of shaking hands, maybe. I am Commander Benjamin Sisko of the United Federation of Planets.
Spock, what do you make of that?
Most unusual. An unknown form of energy of great power and intelligence. Evidently unaware that its transmissions are destructive. I find it illogical that its intentions should be hostile.
Really? You think this is its way of saying hi there to the people of the Earth?
There are other forms of intelligence on Earth, Doctor. Only human arrogance would assume the message must be meant for man.
I've completed my analysis of the anomaly. It appears to be a multiphasic temporal convergence in the space-time continuum.
In English, Data.
It is, in essence, an eruption of anti-time.
Anti-time?
A relatively new concept in temporal mechanics. The relationship between anti-time and normal time is analogous to the relationship between antimatter and normal matter.
So, if time and anti-time were to collide,
they would annihilate one another.
The duplicate atoms couldn't occupy the same point in space-time for very long before.
Mutual annihilation.
We'd both be destroyed. Captain, I think you should return to your ship and run a metallurgical analysis. Find out the precise phase modulation of your hull. I'll do the same here. Maybe we can find a way to realign the phase displacement. You're going to self-destruct your ship. What makes you say that? Because that's what I would do if your Voyager were intact and my Voyager were crippled.
In this galaxy, there's a mathematical probability of 3 million Earth-type planets. And in all of the universe, 3 million galaxies like this. And in all of that, and perhaps more, only one of each of us.
We wanted to see if you had the ability to expand your mind and your horizons. And for one brief moment, you did.
When I realized the paradox.
Exactly. For that one fraction of a second, you were open to options you had never considered. That is the exploration that awaits you. Not mapping stars and studying nebula, but charting the unknown possibilities of existence.
Are you familiar with physical forms of pleasure?
If you are referring to sexuality, I am fully functional, programmed in multiple techniques.
How long has it been since you've used them?
8 years. 7 months, 16 days, 4 minutes, 22.
Far too long.
There was a lot of competition here on the Paramount lot when auditions started 2 years ago for Star Trek Voyager, the fourth incarnation of Star Trek on television. Now, many actors were considered for the various roles, and to show you how that process works, we've asked a group of actors to recreate their audition for you. Now, out of this first group, I'm sad to say, only one actor was actually cast in Voyager. The others had to scramble and kind of do the best they could in the business.
Captain's log, stardate 47259.3. Captain Catherine Janeway, commanding the USS Voyager. She is an untested ship with an untested crew, but I believe over time we will grow to work as an efficient and cooperative team.
Are we going to fly this thing, or are you just going to yak, yak, yak?
Captain, we're getting an order from Starfleet requesting we meet the Enterprise at Starbase 15.
Helm, set a course for 119.41 Mark 8.
Well, sure, if you want to go the long way.
Oh, no, we're not taking another one of your shortcuts. Last one, we followed your advice. We went through a tear in the time-space continuum and wound up in ancient Pompeii.
Well, we escaped, didn't we?
Yes, and my brand-new Romulan loafers were singed beyond recognition.
People, I need your focus.
Captain, we have an unidentified ship approaching at bloody hell. She's really moving.
Commander, hail the vessel. Commander?
Oh, in a second. Really? Is he cute? He's an Aldebaran?
Commander.
Aren't Aldebarians the ones with four tongues?
Sounds like this Aldebaran is about to boldly go where so many men have gone before.
I heard that. Hey, what do you know? They're hailing us, but it's not coming through. There's transmission problems.
Well, that's the trouble with these modern starships. My day had a simple communication system. Didn't have all these fancy flashing lights and dials, but it worked.
I know. It just launched a tin can at the other ship and then pulled back until the string was taut.
But it worked.
Ooh. I believe I have an explanation for our communications problem, Captain. While we were in port, I had them install a banality filter. It keeps us from being bothered by any messages that are overly insipid or jejune.
Disengage the filter.
Oh, I can't. I can't even get my phaser to stop flashing 12 o'clock.
Excuse me, Captain. Members of my species are a bit telepathic. Perhaps I can use my powers to communicate with the alien vessel. Lieutenant, you're not from another planet. You're from England, aren't you?
Shh, quiet. I'm getting something. It's coming through strong now. They want to attack. No. It's not an attack. It's more of a desire to embrace. No. Hold on. Captain, I believe they want to breed with us. Wait a minute. This isn't coming from out there. It's coming from in...
Well, that was fun, wasn't it? I'm sure the captain has another plan she'd like to try.
Oh, why don't you fire a photon torpedo at him?
What if they're a friendly ship?
Well, then it'll be easier. They won't shoot back.
Oh. Captain, I'm reading an energy source from the alien vessel. It's a transporter beam. We're being boarded.
Red alert. Oh, loud noise. Headache.
Oh. Captain, I'm not sure I'm reading this instrument panel correctly, but either we have a malfunction in our left turn signal, or there's an armed Klingon on board the turbo lift.
Shall we assume it's the latter?
Does this belong to you?
Hey, be careful with the dog. Come here, boy.
We found him on the Klingon homeworld. He was digging up azalea bushes, and we've just re-landscaped.
Sorry about that, Ballista Kermit.
Well, yes. But next time it's intergalactic war, I vow we will destroy every molecule of the Federation.
That seems reasonable. Now do you see why we shouldn't have pets on starships?
Well, you let her have a pet. She had that big hairy thing with the horns and the three eyes.
It wasn't a pet. It was a date.
Anyway, it wouldn't have gotten out if somebody hadn't left the shuttle door bay open.
Oh, no, you don't. You're not pinning this on me. You can't expect me to pilot a starship and mind him. Computer, engage self-destruct sequence.
What?
Self-destruct sequence.
Well, if that isn't acting out, I don't know what is.
I don't believe it.
This was all your fault. You picked up on things.
Ladies and gentlemen, John DeLancie.
The universe of the 24th century is not an entirely friendly place. I mean, there you are, mapping a star system, minding your own business when suddenly, zap, somebody's firing at you. Who could it be? The Romulans? The Cardassians? The Ferengi? The Klingons? Well, actually, the Klingons are kind of friendly now, so it's not the Klingons. But if you're really unlucky, your starship might be under attack from the Q, a very particular sort of Star Trek villain distinguished by omnipotent powers, roguish good looks, and an ego as big as the all-outdoors. Now, I'd like to take a moment as that Star Trek villain to speak a word on behalf of villains wherever you may be. In spite of all the trouble we cause our friends in the Federation, we do serve an important purpose. Without us, mankind would simply wander through the galaxy collecting souvenirs and posing for pictures. Villains are like the grit in the polishing machine that turns pebbles into gems. We are the irritant that make the oyster make the pearl. When evil threatens, good unites. And when good unites, mankind prospers. So don't just think of us as villains, but rather think of us as the ones who force mankind to answer the really tough questions. Watch.
You're guilty. Guilty of what?
Of being inferior. 7 years ago, I said we'd be watching you, and we have been. Hoping that your ape-like race would demonstrate some growth, give some indication that your minds had room for expansion. But what have we seen instead? You worrying about Commander Riker's career. Listening to Counselor Troy's pedantic psychobabble. Indulging Data in his witless exploration of humanity?
We've journeyed to countless new worlds. We've contacted new species. We have expanded our understanding of the universe.
In your own paltry, limited way, you have no idea how far you still have to go. But instead of using the last 7 years to change and to grow, you have squandered them.
We are what we are, and we're doing the best we can. It is not for you to set the standards by which we should be judged.
Oh, but it is, and we have. Time may be eternal, Captain, but our patience is not. It's time to put an end to your trek through the stars. Make room for other more worthy species.
You're going to deny us travel through space?
No! You obtuse piece of flotsam. You're to be denied existence. Humanity's fate has been sealed. You will be destroyed.
Q, I do not believe that even you are capable of such an act.
I? There you go again, always blaming me for everything. Well, this time I'm not your enemy. I'm not the one that causes the annihilation of mankind. You are.
Me?
That's right. You're doing it right now. You did it before, and you'll do it yet again.
What sort of meaningless double talk is this?
He doesn't understand! I have only myself to blame, I suppose. I believed in you. I thought you had potential. But apparently I was wrong. May whatever God you believe in have mercy on your soul. This court stands adjourned.
It is obvious to the most simple-minded that Loki is of an inferior breed.
The obvious visual evidence, Commissioner, is that he is of the same breed as yourself.
Are you blind, Commander Spock? Look at me. Look at me.
You're black on one side and white on the other.
I am black on the right side.
I fail to see the significant difference.
Loki is white on the right side. All of his people are white on the right side.
Now tell me, Commander, what is Data?
I don't understand.
What is he?
A machine.
Is he? Are you sure?
Yes.
You see, he's met two of your three criteria for sentience, so what if he meets the third? Consciousness, in even the smallest degree. What is he then? I don't know. Do you? Do you?
Well, consider that in the history of many worlds, there have always been disposable creatures. They do the dirty work. They do the work that no one else wants to do because it's too difficult or too hazardous. And an army of Data is all disposable. You don't have to think about their welfare. You don't think about how they feel. Whole generations of disposable people.
Talking about slavery.
I think that's a little harsh.
I don't think that's a little harsh. I think that's the truth. But that's a truth that we have obscured behind a comfortable, easy euphemism. Property. But that's not the issue at all, is it?
You Federation types are all alike. You talk about tolerance and understanding, but you only practice it towards people who remind you of yourselves. Because you disapprove of Ferengi values, you scorn us, distrust us, insult us every chance you get.
Quark, I don't have to stand here and defend myself.
Tell me, Commander, would you allow your son to marry a Ferengi female?
I never thought about it.
Exactly my point.
I don't want to do anything to hurt you. I did that before. I climbed into a shuttlecraft, and I made you a widow.
I knew you were a pilot when I married you. I knew the risks. I went into it with my eyes wide open.
And what about now? Are your eyes open? Do you know what the risks are?
I thought I'd gotten over you. It's been so long and so much has happened. And now I know I haven't.
Ladies and gentlemen, Nichelle Nichols.
After the first season of Star Trek, I told Gene Roddenberry I had decided to leave the show and return to the theater. Gene asked me to reconsider, to think about it. Well, that same weekend, I went to an NAACP event, and a man came over to me and said, a fan wanted to meet me. Well, I turned, and I discovered that fan to be Dr. Martin Luther King. Dr. King told me that Star Trek was one of the few shows that he and Mrs. King allowed their little children to watch. He said that Uhura, my character, was so important because she was in the first fully integrated cast that portrayed men and women truly as equals. Well, when I mentioned that I was going to leave the show, Dr. King said, you can't do that. He said, your character is the first non-stereotypical role on television and is in a position of authority. People who don't look like us see us for the first time as we should be seen, as equals. Don't you see, he said, Star Trek has changed the face of television. Well, I told Gene Roddenberry that I would stay with the show. It was one of the best decisions I ever made. For 10 years later, Uhura and I would recruit the very first women and minority astronauts for NASA's space shuttle program. Obviously, it changed that face, too. I will always be indebted to Gene Roddenberry for my role on Star Trek and to Dr. Martin Luther King for encouraging me to stay aboard the Starship Enterprise.
Ladies and gentlemen, LeVar Burton.
I am here with a heartfelt tip of the hat from those of us who work in front of the camera to some of those who work behind the camera. In fact, I have had the great good fortune of working both sides of this camera street, and in my first episode of Star Trek as a director, I had a baptism of fire that gave me a real and true appreciation for those wizards who create what we refer to as those visual effects. In the episode, I had several scenes to stage with one actor playing two roles. The actor, my good and talented friend, Mr. Jonathan Frakes, and as talented as he is, no disrespect intended, I knew from the start that there was no way we were going to pull this off by ourselves. So, to the wizards I turned, and I got a crash course in the magic done by these unsung heroes. I've just been flabbergasted over the years by the genius that goes into what we see on the screen and take for granted when we see these episodes, like the beaming effect. Everybody knows what it's like to beam in and beam out, but did you know that the effect is actually sparkles, glitter, in a bowl of water that's stirred, not shaken? These people take little pieces of model and little pieces of plastic and they put it together and they come up with a shuttle that'll fly through a scene. They'll tell you that this piece of plastic is from a Bic razor and that this is from a model that I stole from my kid. In fact, one of these wizards, Dan Curry, says that when he walks through a hardware store and cruises the plumbing section, he doesn't see plumbing supplies at all. He sees spaceship parts. So now let's take a look at some of the special effect creations from these masters and mistresses of illusion. And to match the magic of pictures with the magic of music, we have with us tonight one of the finest musicians of our time. Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Kenny G.
and gentlemen, John Larroquette.
Good evening. Early in my career, I had the luck to be cast in the motion picture Star Trek III, Search for Spock. It was my first shot at a film with an extraordinary cast and guest stars like Christopher Lloyd, Dame Judith Anderson, and directed by Leonard Nimoy. Sorry. I think it was that pate at the cocktail party. Well, I'm sure glad this isn't live. That would really be embarrassing. Undeniably an amazing experience, that stuff I told you before. As a cast member of the Search for Spock, I couldn't help but notice the amazing attention to detail. All of the working control panels and the bridges and the lights and the costumes. Makeup alone was a four-hour ordeal that started at 5 o'clock in the morning with prosthetics and wigs. They did a good job. They did a great job. I was unrecognizable. I came to the party dressed like this, as a matter of fact. Okay? Klingon officer, Maltz. I gave my first name secretly Chocolate. That's me under all of that. Look at those eyes. Those are my eyes. Those are definitely my eyes. I worked with Christopher Lloyd every day for a month at the premiere. He had no idea who I was. Leonard Nimoy had a real ear for detail. Klingons speak in a series of... Oh, I see. That's a joke, isn't it? Series grunts and clicks, Klingon is, sounding something like a really drunken Scotsman, although that may be redundant. Easy enough to learn, but somewhere between Star Trek II and Star Trek III, some guy wrote down the entire language. I had to take 2 semesters of Klingon under his tutelage, teaching Klingon to actors. Now, there's a job description, I tell you. I don't know if my professor is here, and I'm a little rusty, but here goes. Nook. Dak uk puk pa'i. No, I really do have to go. Where's the little Klingon's room? Dak vitel dil mach kush. How much for that hat? Kash tak vish varum los shad. The throats of 4,000 men may be cut by a running man with a knife. Because that's the colloquial translation. This guy, by the way, he asked me to tell you, he has put out a couple of books. If you'd like to, you can pick up the Klingon tapes. They're available everywhere. And you should check them out. There's Conversational Klingon, for favorite for long rides across country, and Power Klingon, great for power interviews before them, and breakfasts, too. I played a Klingon, but I wanted to play a human, much like tonight. And the funny thing about Star Trek is there are a lot of aliens out there who want to be human.
Hello, I'm Leonard Nimoy. I'm in Paris today on my way back to Morocco, where I'm portraying the prophet Samuel in the biblical story of David. And that by way of answer to one of the most often asked questions, how did Star Trek affect your acting career? And the answer is very positive. I've had the great fortune of having steady work offered to me ever since Star Trek went on the air. The other question about being identified with an alien is a little bit more complex and probably more interesting. I wonder why it is that, and I'm sure other people do, that these characters like Spock and other aliens in Star Trek have attracted so many fans and so many followers over the years. I have the feeling that these outsiders, these people who are not like us, these people who are different, in a way tell us something about ourselves. I think that all of us at one time in our lives have experienced being the outsider, feeling like everybody else knows what's going on, I'm not quite getting it. Everybody else knows exactly what clothes to wear, exactly what music to listen to, exactly who to hang out with, and I'm just not quite getting it. And I think in this respect, Spock and people like him speak for all of us and give us a sense that our true dignity comes from our own real sense of self-worth. So here's to Spock and all his fellow aliens. May they all live long and prosper.
Row, row, row your boat gently down the stream.
Row,
merrily,
row,
merrily,
row
merrily, merrily,
lightly down the stream.
Merrily, 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 merrily. Come on, Spock. Why didn't you jump in?
I was trying to comprehend the meaning of the words.
It's a song, you green-blooded Vulcan. You sing it. The words aren't important. What's important is that you have a good time singing it.
Oh, I am sorry, Doctor. We'll be having a good time.
God, I liked him better before he died.
All right. Let's call it a night, would you?
Fascinating. You have an efficient intellect, superior physical skills, no emotional impediments. There are Vulcans who aspire all their lives to achieve what you've been given by design.
You are half human.
Yes.
Yet you have chosen a Vulcan way of life.
I have.
In effect, you have abandoned what I have sought all my life.
O soave fanciulla. Oh.
He's been studying opera. What's wrong with that?
It wasn't programmed to be a tenor. It was programmed to be a physician.
What's wrong with wanting to be more than that?
It's superfluous. Look at me. I've got the same matrix, the same hollow array, the same neural pathways as it does. You don't see me cluttering up my circuits with irrelevancies. I'm content to be the best possible diagnostic program I can be. Your EMH should be happy to be a fine physician.
The doctor has taken it upon himself to become a person who grows and learns and feels. It's made him a better physician.
An EMH program can't feel anything. Its emotional reactions are simply a series of algorithms designed to make it easier to interact with.
He's much more than that. And I've known him for most of my life. He's one of my closest friends.
You can't possibly believe that this program shares these feelings.
I know he does.
For 34 years, I have endeavored to become more human. To grow beyond my original programming. Still, I am unable to grasp such a basic concept as humor. This emotion chip may be the only answer.
What?
I believe this beverage has produced an emotional response.
Really? What are you feeling?
I am uncertain. Because I have had little experience with emotion, I am unable to articulate the sensation.
Emotion? I'll explain later. Ooh! Well, it looks like he hates it.
Yes. That is it.
I hate this!
Data, I think the chip is working.
Oh, yes! I hate this! It is revolting!
More?
Please.
Constable.
Listen, Captain. You hear it?
You mean the bubbles?
Soothing, isn't it? You know, before I became a solid, I never heard that. I had no sense of taste, so I never paid much attention to food or drink. I had no idea how seductive they could be. Would you like me to get you a glass?
I'm on duty.
I'm not.
I thought you were always on duty.
You know, at first, I found the whole process of ingestion disgusting. But now that I've gotten used to it, I find eating and drinking to be quite comforting. It's one of the few things that you... that we humanoids have control over.
Welcome aboard, Captain.
I thought I was going to die.
Not possible.
You were never alone. Please, Captain. Not in front of the Klingons.
All I ask is a tall ship and a star to steer her by.
Melville, John Misfield.
Are you sure about that?
I am well versed in the classics, Doctor.
Then how come you don't know row, row, row your boat?
Star Trek, 30 Years and Beyond, continues with a musical tribute to Gene Roddenberry. Ladies and gentlemen, Marina Sirtis.
Almost 10 years ago to the day, I arrived in America. 6 months later, and after six grueling weeks of auditions, I was getting my suitcase down. My visa had run out, I was out of money, and I had a prepaid ticket back to England when the phone rang, and my agent said, "You've got the part in Star Trek: The Next Generation." 10 years on, I still find it unbelievable that I'm involved in this huge phenomenon. I feel very honored to have had a relationship with Gene Roddenberry and his family. Not only was he a visionary in terms of television, what people wanted to see, but he was also a very kind and gentle man who embraced me and treated me like one of the family, which I really appreciated as I was an alien in a strange land. When Gene passed on, Rick Berman reminded us that the show must go on. Rick picked up the mantle and has carried it with great distinction ever since. A lot of people want to view the world as Star Trek does, an optimistic, non-judgmental view, believing that it's not what's on the outside of people, whether it's snake people or lizard people or fish people, it's what's on the inside that matters. Now, to remind us of that, the spirit and humanity that Gene Roddenberry and Rick Berman gave us in the Star Trek universe, here is Jennifer Larmour.
Imagine then no countries. I wonder if you can. No need for greed or hunger. A brotherhood of men. Imagine all the peace. You may
Hello. If the... Look, I'm really sorry. Will you please tell Her Majesty no autographs? I don't care how much the corgis love the show. Forget it. I'm really sorry. If the fictional technology of the 24th century were really available today, then I would be a roistering, rambunctious part of tonight's celebrations. Instead, a bit of pre-recorded tape being queued up in a control room by some producer. But, you see, for the past 10 years, I've had two families. One genetic, here in England, and the other one celebrating there at Paramount. And this weekend, my family of more than 50 years must take precedence over my new family of only 10 years. And I am so sad not to be with you all tonight. But congratulations to all of us. And here's to the next 30 years. Yeah, I think I can get by without using the walking frame in this next shot. Tonight, you've traveled through the galaxies that grew out of the fertile imagination of Gene Roddenberry and the other creators of Star Trek. But also, during these three decades, we have seen an era of scientific advancement that's been unmatched in human history. And if you think of the parallel adventures that have occurred in the real world of science and aeronautics, and that grew out of the realm of the imagination, not far from this spot, a poet once wrote of the human aspiration that compels some men and women to write stories and others to fly away from Earth's gravity. More than 100 years ago, Robert Browning wrote, "If our reach does not exceed our grasp, then what is heaven for?"
Someone once told me that time was a predator that stalked us all our lives. And I rather believe that time is a companion who goes with us on the journey, reminds us to cherish every moment, because it'll never come again. What we leave behind is not as important as how we've lived.
I believe that this nation should commit itself to achieving the goal, before this decade is out, of landing a man on the moon and returning him safely to the earth.
Thank you.
After all, number one, we're only mortal.
Ladies and gentlemen, Avery Brooks.
As one who serves as captain of Deep Space Nine in the sound stages of Paramount and has the opportunity to tell the stories of space for the world to see, I have considerable admiration for the men and women who take the great risks and actually venture into space. Thus, it is an honor to introduce the man who made a mark in space that sets him apart. He was the pilot of the Apollo 11 lunar module, who can never forget July 20th, 1969. And the drama of that moment in history when two men set foot on the moon for the first time. Ladies and gentlemen, one of those men is with us tonight, Dr. Buzz Aldrin.
Thank you very much. I often think how much attention in America today is focused on the short term, the right now, immediate self-gratification. I believe Star Trek's most important contribution has been to light up the imagination of Americans and the entire world, projecting it outward to the future, projecting in such a hopeful and helpful way that advances our understanding of technology and helps us understand ourselves. I happily serve as elected chairman of the National Space Society, and we strongly urge the expansion of human presence outward. We support an increased program of space exploration beyond the horizons of today. So here's a salute to Star Trek's 24th century and to the outward journey of the human race in the 21st century. It's now my pleasure to introduce a valued colleague and fellow astronaut, Dr. Mae Jemison.
Thank you, Buzz. Ladies and gentlemen, like Buzz, I've had the unique honor of thrill of going into space and seeing the Earth from a different perspective. Unfortunately, unlike Buzz, I didn't have an opportunity to walk on the moon. But there is one thing that I did that Buzz didn't. I'm the only astronaut who ever actually appeared on an episode of Star Trek and traveled on the Starship Enterprise. Since I can remember, I always wanted to go into space, and I assumed that one day I would. And when Star Trek hit the airwaves in 1966, here was a program that pointed the way and demanded a very hopeful future, one in which all people on Earth had finally learned to work together. In each episode, folks of all races, genders, and even species boldly met challenges with positive spirits. But you see, I had one small problem with Star Trek. In the original series, one episode said women could not be starship captains. And even as a girl, I knew that it wasn't quite forward-looking. But we all grow, and now there's Captain Janeway. Nichelle Nichols brought to life Star Trek's Lieutenant Uhura, one of the first women and black people in a non-traditional technical role. She was an affirmation that I was not alone in my determination to go into space. And I'm very happy that we've been able to become friends. And before I went into space, I made Nichelle a promise. I started my ships on the shuttle Endeavour with the words to Huntsville, "All hailing frequencies are open." My life is centered around science and ways to ensure that all people benefit from its advances. Star Trek helps to bring that connection to life. The importance of Star Trek to me is the society that it created, the characters who speak to us, and the plots that help us to examine our own world in a new light. I was excited to have a small role on Star Trek, and it wasn't just to meet Worf, but really to underscore the connection between fantasy and reality. The creativity that brings about a Star Trek springs from the very same source as a creativity that searches for cures for debilitating illnesses or that launches a space shuttle. Our fantasies are the stepping stones to our realities. The better our fantasies can be, the better our realities can become. Star Trek is one of our very best fantasies. So it is with a sense of honor and camaraderie that NASA, the National Aeronautics and Space Administration, presents these flags flown in space aboard the space shuttle Atlantis and the Russian space station Mir to the crews of the starships Enterprise and Voyager and the station Deep Space Nine. It says, "In recognition of your role in inspiring the bold spirit of exploration and helping us all see the tremendous possibilities for the future of humankind."
Nichelle Nichols. DeForest Kelly. Robert Beltran. Terry Farrell. Tim Russ. Surratt Lawton. LeVar Burton. Armin Shimmerman. Robert Picardo. Nana Visitor. Ethan Phillips. Cole Meany. Michael Dorn. Roxanne Dawson. Renee Aubergenois. Garrett Wong. Jennifer Lean. Robert McNeil. Walter Koenig. George Takei. Gates McFadden. Brent Spiner. Jimmy Doohan. Marina Sirtis.
Ladies and gentlemen, it is now our pleasure to introduce Jonathan Frakes from Star Trek: The Next Generation.
The captain from Deep Space Nine, Avery Brooks.
The captain from Voyager, Kate Mulgrew.
The captain from the original Star Trek, William Shatner.
On behalf of NASA, thank you and congratulations.
On behalf of all my colleagues, I want to say a heartfelt thank you to NASA and its administrator, Dan Golden, and to Buzz Aldrin. Buzz, I like a name like Buzz, don't you? Mae Jemison, and for this recognition to all of us. The destinies of NASA and Star Trek have been intertwined through the years, especially in the very beginning, when Americans would gather around their television sets and watch the rocket launches live. When the rockets would go up, our ratings would go up. When the rockets crashed, we got moved to Friday nights at 10. The example of the astronauts, their courage and their discipline was always an inspiration to us at Star Trek, as well as to Americans everywhere. They taught us that there is nothing that mankind cannot accomplish. They aimed at the moon, and they reached it. We await journeys ahead to Mars and Venus and exploration vehicles going to the stars. So we thank NASA for all they have done, are doing, and we thank them too for that inspiration that has become the life support of so many lives, including mine, leading people in our profession and others into a variety of careers that would not have existed without NASA and Star Trek. So NASA and Star Trek, live long and prosper. Good night.